Well, here you are. How many of you had enough time to get supper? How many of you left the restaurant without getting supper? We're a little bit delayed tonight. Folks are trickling in, but we want to get started. We don't want to go too late this evening, and so I want to welcome you to our third gathering. And tonight we have the special privilege of hearing from our outgoing Northeast area pastor, Reverend Terry Shanahan. And so our program is all designed around that. And I am going to call up Claire Hustis to lead us in the responsive call to worship.
Join me in Psalm 34. It'll be a call and response. I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. I will boast only in the Lord. Let all who are helpless take heart. Come, let us see, tell of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt his name together. Those who look to him for help will be radiant with joy. No shadow of shame will darken their faces. For the angel of the Lord is a guard. He surrounds and defends all who fear him.
Please stand. Join us in worship.
You rest with the sinner restless.
God is good, amen? And all we need is His grace. It's nothing that we do. It's all Him. Praise Jesus. He's our good friend. He's our Father and our friend.
What a friend.
Be seated.
Good afternoon, or evening. I guess it's evening. My name is Stephen Baker, and I've been asked to offer a testimony about my experiences in our area pastor groups. I am quite honestly a new kid on the block. I came from Phoenix, Arizona, all the way out to Candia, New Hampshire. And not only is the weather different, but the culture is very, very different. And it's been groups like this, whether it was Ed Whitman at Raymond Baptist Church or my time with Overseed with Mo, I see you over there, or the group that I'm in with today that has helped me navigate those often very difficult waters and times. And so my question to you, or the answer that I want to give you, is why you should be involved in an area pastor group if you're not already. You are never called to do it alone. You were never called to shoulder the weight of a church or of pastoring or ministering on your own. For a time, I tried to do it. And if it hadn't been for these men and the wisdom that they shared with me, I wouldn't be here today. So I praise God regularly for the involvement that they have been in my life. I want to introduce you to the men that I get to meet with on a regular month. They're not really a Paul or a Barnabas, but they're kind of maybe a Paulibus, I guess, maybe, a Paulibus. So if you're in here, John, I want you to stand up. This is John. John is retiring from Derry Congregational Church, and a phrase, a word that has stuck out in my mind of Paul's when he writes to the Corinthians is, I follow Christ, so follow me. I want John's faithfulness, his steadfastness, the example that he has set. I want to be like him because he is like Christ. Mark, there you are. Mark, stand up. This is Mark, pastor of Goffstown Church. Some of our most thoughtful and encouraging and challenging conversations have come from questions he has brought to the table because they are things that he is personally wrestling with or wrestling with his congregation, whether it's how to vaccinate a camel, whether it's how do you run a hospital in the Middle East, or how do you love your congregation that is experiencing tremendous suffering and pain from loss. I want his mind, because he has the mind of Christ. Where is Craig? Craig, stand up. This is Craig, pastor of Rand Memorial Church in Seabrook, New Hampshire. Stay standing. He doesn't follow instructions well, but he is a wonderful man and a godly pastor. I want his winsome and fearless love for his people. He loves his congregation so well, and he does it without fear. Every time he talks about a challenge, he laughs, because I believe he trusts Jesus when he says, in this life you will have trouble, but have no fear, for I have overcome the world. And so I want your fearless and winsome love for your congregation. My associate pastor, Robin, is not here this afternoon, evening, but I want his courage, his fearlessness. He sold everything that he and his family owned in Phoenix, Arizona, to come to be a volunteer associate pastor, because he wants to follow Jesus and his call. So if you are a church that is looking for an associate pastor and you'll pay a little bit of money, let me come see me after this, because I'm trying to find him that forever home. So why should you be involved in a pastor's group? Because you're going to be able to interact with men and women, individuals just like these, and God will use them to conform you into the image of his son, Jesus Christ, through their winsome love, their fearlessness, their mind, their steadfastness, and their faithfulness. You will become a better pastor. You will become a better spouse. You will become a better friend. But most importantly, you'll become a better life for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. People will see the way that you live, and they will say, there is something different, there is something special, and I want that. Last, and I didn't forget, Terry Shanahan. Stand up. This mic's not even on. I don't know why I'm playing with it. We're congregationalists, so we don't have much polity. But in our group, we refer to Terry as the bishop. And so when he tells you to do something, you do it. And for Terry Shanahan, what I desire to be like is to have your humble authenticity. Terry's a man who shows up and says, you see what you get.
Absolutely.
The pause wasn't for laughter, Terry. But you see what you get. And what you see is a man who loves God and who loves to tell the story. And so I'm really looking forward to what you have to share for
thank
tonight.
You.
Terry,
yeah.
Thank you so very
yeah.
much. You have been a wonderful
too,
friend and important influence in my life. And I'm here tonight because of you. So, well, quite literally, he asked me to do this. So, I want to leave you with a question. Why am I not involved in a pastor's group? If you are, that's great. Whether it's one of our area pastor's group or just another pastor's group that's formed in your area, I want to say thank you for being involved in one. But if you're not, why? You will be a better pastor. You will be a better minister. You will have more courage and more strength to do the work that God has called you to do. Your family will benefit, your friends will benefit, and the kingdom will benefit. So, thank you.
Good evening, folks. I'm Mark Gothier, the chaplaincy endorser for the Four Seas, and our chaplains have the privilege of taking the offering this evening, so I invite them to come forward with their yellow bags and stand up front. You may ask, why do we take offerings at the annual gathering? One is expenses far outpace income in the summer times. You may say, hey, but I paid my annual gathering fee. Doesn't that help? That covers expenses, but not the above and beyond to minister to our churches and conferences. And these offerings are especially helpful in times of the pandemic when many churches have been struggling to be able to serve our churches and to serve our pastors well. So let me pray, and then we'll let our chaplains do their thing. Our Father, we are grateful that the most important gift you've given us is your Son. And all the grace that has been made accessible to us by his death on the cross. And so, Lord, we just acknowledge that everything that we give back is just a small, small token of our gratitude back to you. So bless these folks who give, and may you use these offerings tenfold, Lord, to be able to accomplish the work and the purposes of the kingdom of God. And so we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
God was satisfied.
Tell my church folks, sometimes the Holy Spirit leaks out my eyeballs. It is not a mistake that the first of our seven guiding values as an organization is a culture of believing prayer and intercession. And it is the foundation of what we do, and it is the foundation of who we are, to be a people of prayer. And so tonight we want to enter into some corporate prayer together. And we're going to do that using a method that was taught to us by a speaker at a previous annual gathering. His name is Daniel Henderson, and his book is called Transforming Prayer. And it's about transforming us through prayer as well as transforming the way we pray. And so we learn about these prayer exercises where you can use a scripture or a song as a base and sing or read and then pray in pieces in between. So tonight we're going to sing the song, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. And in between each of the verses, we're going to pause and pray. And so I want to encourage you, if you're not, when we start singing, if you're not already sitting next to somebody or near somebody, to move a little bit so you can connect with one other person or a couple other people. There'll be some prayer prompts on the screen. These are ideas that flow out of the words of the music, but you can pray whatever you feel led to pray. And after we pray for a few minutes, then we'll go ahead and sing the next verse, and then we'll pray some more, and then we'll sing the third verse and pray a little bit more. So I encourage you to enter into the presence of God through the power of prayer and the gift of this worship as we sing about God's deep love. Together and thank God for the gift of His deep love. Turn our eyes to Jesus, who died on our behalf on the cross.
Yeah.
thank God for the times he has rescued us from the darkness and brought us into the light. The power of Jesus that we find the only thing worth boasting about. For those we know who need God's grace, who need to understand the rescue they can have, let's pray for those who need Jesus. As our hearts continue those prayers, I invite you to stand and sing together this third verse one last time about the power of where we find our meaning. There is enough paper that has diplomas printed on it in this room that we could paper the walls. And yet, we have nothing to boast about. There is enough history of good and great work that we have done and been part of that could fill newspapers. And yet, we have nothing worth boasting about. We have given and sacrificed
and offered grace and mercy, and yet we have nothing to boast about, because what we have done does not even begin to come close to the start of what you already accomplished. And so we stand here tonight, so grateful, so awestruck by your majesty and your power and your glory, and so grateful that you have entrusted us with the job of telling others. Jesus, may you use the words of scripture tonight, the words of music tonight, the words of prayer tonight, to change us, to look even more like you, that others would want to know who you are and never even remember who we were. To your honor, to your glory, thank you. Amen. You may be seated.
Good evening. My name is Dave Coons. I'm pastor at Jericho Congregational Church in Jericho, Vermont. Let me invite you to open up your Bibles to the book of Hebrews, the 13th chapter. I'll be reading verses 1 through 16. I'll be reading from the NLT. I think the NIV will be here on the screen. Feel free to read along or just to close your eyes and receive and listen to God's word to us tonight. Hebrews 13. Keep on loving each other as brothers and sisters. Don't forget to show hospitality to strangers, for some who have done this have entertained angels without realizing it. Remember those in prison as if you were there yourself. Remember also those being mistreated as if you felt their pain in your own bodies. Give honor to marriage and remain faithful to one another in marriage. God will surely judge people who are immoral and those who commit adultery. Don't love money. Be satisfied with what you have. For God has said, I will never fail you. I will never abandon you. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will have no fear. What can mere people do to me? Remember your leaders who taught you the word of God. Think of all the good that has come from their lives. Follow the example of their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So do not be attracted by strange new ideas. Your strength comes from God's grace, not from rules about food, which don't help those who follow them. We have an altar from which the priests in the tabernacle have no right to eat. Under the old system, the high priest brought the blood of animals into the holy place as a sacrifice for sin, and the bodies of the animals were burned outside the camp. So also Jesus suffered and died outside the city gates to make his people holy by means of his own blood. So let us go out to him outside the camp and bear the disgrace he bore. For this world is not our permanent home. We are looking forward to a home yet to come. Therefore, let us offer through Jesus a continual sacrifice of praise to God, proclaiming our allegiance to his name. And don't forget to do good and to share with those in need. These are the sacrifices that please God.
Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Tim Bogerman. I'm the senior pastor at the First Congregational Church in Revere. It's my opportunity tonight to introduce Terry Shanahan to us. Terry is interesting. In fact, you could say Terry Shanahan is the most interesting regional pastor in all the world. He was once bit by a rattlesnake, and after 5 days of excruciating pain, the snake died. When Terry met the Pope kissed his ring. Bear hugs are what Terry gives to bears. His business card simply says, "I'll call you." Terry is the most interesting regional pastor in all the world. But seriously, Terry is a great regional pastor. When I first came to the Four Seas 15 years ago, he came into this position, and having had him as our regional pastor has been a blessing. How many of us in the Northeast can think of times when Terry came alongside of us? Could be churches in crisis, times we need advice, and Terry showed up to help us. Pastors in need and crisis who were seeking advice, and he came to them. Church plants, exciting new opportunities, and Terry was there to help that begin and to connect people to those church plants and get excited about what God was doing. Most of all, I think of the times when Terry would show up and all the events we'd go to in the Four Seas with all the updates and stories he would share. Terry always had an exciting word to give us, reminders of what God is doing in our conference, the good news of God, always with a smile on Terry's face, no matter what he was facing, and showing us the good news of Jesus, and a laugh every time, and reminds us of the good news of Jesus and what he is doing. He would tell us the story and remind us again of Jesus and his love for us and for our conference. And even now, as Terry begins to depart and give us his swan song tonight and passes on the baton to in a wonderful way to Paul McFeeters, and we're excited about that baton toss and what that means, we celebrate what God has done. We say, "Thank you, Lord, for Terry. And we thank you, Terry, for your 15 years of service to us, to remind us of Jesus and to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love." Come on up, Terry. Come join us.
Love you, man. Love you, dear.
Oh, dear. Thank you. Thank you. That's a little bit overwhelming and maybe awkward. I'm not sure. But Tim, thank you for that very humbling introduction. Well, at the end it was humbling. The beginning was. So Tim is an example of our next generation of pastor who served as an associate pastor for a dozen years at Revere and is now the senior pastor there. And as you saw at the credentials today, all the next generation pastors that we're calling up and how the conference is changing and the face of the conference is changing. And while I'm here, I wanted to say a word about our president, Alvin Helms, because I have that opportunity and what's he gonna do, fire me? Yep. So if you were at our delegate meeting this morning, Alvin led you through our passion and our pathways and our priorities. He did an amazing report on the fact that he's been with the conference for 30 years and he's seen the changes and he's seen the churches and the pastors that have been drawn to us under this biblical umbrella. But one thing Alvin can't tell you is about his own gift of encouragement. And I gotta tell you a story about encouragement, Alvin Helms, to me. It happened just today. I was before lunch, I was walking down the hall, Alvin saw me in the hall, and he knew I was preaching tonight. He said, "Terry, shouldn't you be resting?" So, Alvin has been a real Barnabas to me. I mean, he's like... If pastors were honest, they'd stand up here and they'd tell you they're a little anxious before they're going to preach. I'm not that anxious now. I told some others that you folks should be worried, but I'm not at all worried. No, seriously, I have some anxiety dreams that come from time to time before a night of... I travel all over the Northeast, preaching in a different venue every Sunday, so I have to travel somewhere to another church and preach in another pulpit. So I have this dream that I can't find the venue, and I drive around all day long, and these people are just sitting there, and they're waiting for me to come, and I never show up. The second dream is I can't find my Bible, I can't find my notes, I can't find my sermon, and I come up here, and I've got nothing to say. I just stand here. Of course, the third dream, the scariest one, is those dreams where you can't find your clothes and you don't want to be up here. Didn't want to be here without the clothes. So, and just the fourth dream, this is the last dream, recurring all the time, usually has to do with the microphone. And you're wearing this thing on your hip and you're trying to get it to work and stuff, and by the time I get it on, I look out, everybody's gone. So, but I see you're still here, so. Keeping with a historic theme, I wanted to greet you with a famous greeting from St. Francis as he met Brother Dominic on the road to Umbria. St. Francis said to Brother Dominic, "Hi, how are you?" That's an ancient greeting I bring to you. Our annual gathering is just such a fantastic time. Come together, catching up with one another, time to live out our shared life and live out our shared mission. Chance to tell our individual stories. It's a great time to laugh together, to cry together, pray together. This meeting is historic, not just because we were supposed to have it years ago. It's historic because of the theme on this rock. We're looking at the history of the church, the history of Congregationalism, history of the Four Seas. What a great start we had last night with Pastor Nick. What a great start on Christ-centered Congregationalism. And all those stories that Nick could tell us, historical stories. And Drew, today, could he have a little more energy? A little sluggish, wasn't he? Awesome. Just awesome. Thank you, Drew, for taking us through the history of church planting in Antioch and telling all those stories. It was just great to hear. It's important to look at our history. It's important to tell the stories. There are those that want to cancel history, or at least alter it, or change the narrative. And I'm saying it's imperative that we diligently and deliberately tell the story, because we have the greatest story that has ever been told. And we have the narrative. We have the systematic recitation of events that is given to us through God's word. We also have the meta-narrative, the grand story that is self-legitimizing, that Christ came to reconcile us to God and put to death our sins and to put to death death itself. How can we not tell the story to a dead and dying world? I recently sent off to Ancestry.com with my DNA. They have the ability to look at your genetic makeup and give back a report of your family of origin. I was a little apprehensive because someone I knew whose family lore said that she was an American Indian, and she got her results back, and they came back as Western European. No ties to American Indian at all. She didn't know she could attend the next family powwow or not. But I received my results back. And Ancestry.com said it would be a very, very rare thing to be 100% anything. Well, guess what? I'm 100% Irish. And that's not surprising, and at the same time, it explains a lot about me, but, and I won't go into all that explains, but, one thing that comes out of the history of the Shanahan clan is the Gaelic title of Shanachie. Now, Shanachie is a traditional Irish storyteller. The word means a bearer of old lore. So certainly through generations, this has been the case in my family. So in my blood, there is a penchant for storytelling. And as we go to Shanahan family reunions, there's always someone from the older generations, oftentimes me, telling all the stories for the family. And there's usually some from younger generations who are rolling their eyes and saying, haven't we heard this story before? But then as they get older, they start to pick up the narrative and they themselves start telling the stories. My granddaughter's favorite thing to do when she was little was to say, Papa, tell me the story when you were little. And I would. And as an adult, she bought me a book with blank pages that she asked me to fill in the story of my life, which I intend to do in my retirement. But telling the story, telling God's story, is important if we're going to reach people for Christ. First, we need to get to know people. We actually need to listen to their story. And we need to tell them our story before and after we've come to know Christ. We need to be sure to tell them God's story, the greatest story ever told. How can we not? How can we not? Well, here's the bad news. We're not telling the story. According to Don Everts from InterVarsity in his book, The Reluctant Witness, Christians are having very few conversations about our faith in any given year. 74% of Christians are having less than 10 spiritual conversations a year. We have the greatest story to tell, but we're keeping it to ourselves. Now, in my lifetime, I've experienced the changes in the church. In my elementary school back in the 1950s, kids in my class went to church. All the kids in my class went to church somewhere. There was an acknowledgement that God existed, and God was not marginalized. Even in my public school, we read the Bible and we prayed and we recited the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag each and every day. And God's story was talked about in public in the 1950s. Indeed, church records tell us that in America, church attendance and membership was at the peak in the 1950s. Then the 1960s saw the exit of my generation, the baby boomers. We believed that we had invented sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and we were of a mind to always question authority. In the 1980s, the baby boomers and their families came back to church through the attractional church model, but the church has been declining ever since, with Generation X and the millennials less oriented to church. So the concern today is that 85% of all churches are plateaued or declining. Growing congregations are growing mostly by transfer growth. Small congregations are getting smaller, with the mainline congregations declining the fastest. Professor Jim Singleton of Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary says that many of the churches tried using the little Bo Peep method of getting the sheep back in the church. You remember, little Bo Peep lost her sheep and doesn't know where to find them. Well, leave them alone. They'll come home, bringing their tails behind them. But little Bo Peep fell fast asleep and dreamt she heard them bleating. But when she awoke, she found it a joke because they were still fleeing. That type of evangelism was not very effective because leaving them alone didn't bring them back. In fact, more were even fleeing. Now, here's the next verse of that famous nursery rhyme. Then up she took her little crook, determined for to find them. She found them indeed, but it made her heart bleed, for they left their tails behind them. By the time she'd taken up her crook, round them up, they were missing their tails because they were all wounded. They're all wounded. There are a number of wounded sheep out there who need to be brought back to the fold. We should be about the business of gathering the wounded sheep and reaching the lost. But how do we do that? Well, we do it by telling the story. Folks, to a large extent, our churches and parishioners are not feeling equipped to tell the story. Not equipped to share their faith. Despite the number of books on evangelism and discipleship and the number of classes and trainings that we offer, many do not feel capable. And I hear people say, I don't think I'm much of an evangelist, or I'm not sure how I could be a disciple maker. Well, can you tell your story? Could you ask them about their story? Is that a possibility? Can you tell them the story? The story of a God who came to save? Can you start having conversations with people that lead to a discussion of faith? People, we have to capture a love for telling the story. Our 4C way of life is to love God, love others, and as you go, make disciples. And it's in that as you go part that you're going to be connecting with people and you're going to be telling that story. Can you tell your story in a few minutes? I was born in Michigan, raised in an Irish Catholic family. Church was important to us. We were at church every Sunday, every High Holy Day. We went to confession every Saturday, took communion every Sunday. We had catechism classes. My two older brothers were altar boys. We were a family of prayer, prayers at our meals, prayers whenever there was a special need. I believed in a God of creation, God of the universe, heard about the mystery of the Trinity. I knew God knew me and cared for me. He was a personal God that I talked to every day. But I had no understanding of what Christ had done for me on the cross. I was learning about a works righteousness. I was supposed to earn my way into heaven by being good. And if you knew Terry Shanahan, that wasn't going to happen. So as a teenager, I had a crisis of faith. I had a crisis of faith when I realized I could never achieve that status of good enough to enter heaven. I was invited to a Young Life group, and I heard the gospel clearly, and I understood that none of us are good enough to enter the kingdom. It's only through Christ's sacrifice that our debt of sin is paid. And I accepted Christ for salvation then, but it was years later, after a lot of life had been lived, that I made him Lord of my life, and I committed to serve him all of my days. Now, there were a lot of supporting characters in my journey of faith. I didn't have that single moment in time when darkness came to light. My journey of faith was more gradual. There were important incremental moments during seasons of my life. I understand that this is often the case with people. They say people coming to faith may have had 9 times of hearing parts of the gospel. They may have had 5 different encounters with people sharing their story. There may have been some years of incubation before conversion. But they won't even have that opportunity if we don't tell the story. The story we tell never changes. How and where we tell the story may change. But the story itself never changes. Our scripture for this evening from Hebrews 13, verse 8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Our story doesn't change because Jesus is our story, and Jesus doesn't change. Jesus is the same yesterday. We have that recorded for us, don't we? Jesus is the Logos. John 1, 1 through 5 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, and without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it." From the New and the Old Testaments, we have the record of yesterday. Jesus was the Logos. Jesus became incarnate. Jesus died and rose again to save the world from sin. One of our favorite courses that Carlotta and I took together at Gordon-Conwell was with our 4C professor, Dr. Gordon Hugenberger, who spoke many times at our conferences. And that course was called Christ in the Old Testament. And class after class, lesson after lesson, Dr. Hugenberger illuminated the Old Testament for us. That if you were looking, you could not miss it. These ancient writings were all about the one who was to come, to be the once and forever sacrifice for the sins of the world, so that mankind would be reconciled to God. Of course, Dr. Hugenberger told the story well. He made it come alive for us. And if you know him, he always went past the allotted time. He brought more materials than you could present in even one day. It was amazing what he had. And yet, we didn't leave the classroom because it was so compelling. And for those who say we only need the New Testament to know Jesus and that we don't need to know the Old Testament, I couldn't disagree with you more. From the gospel accounts, we know the yesterday of when Jesus walked this earth. We know that Jesus himself taught by telling stories. From the small, more intimate gatherings to some larger gatherings, he taught about the kingdom of God, what you must do to enter in. And Jesus taught them the way. And when Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know the way," Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." Amen? Amen. So we know that Jesus is the same yesterday. Theologians, historians, archaeologists, lay people, we all have access to the sameness of Christ in the yesterday. Jesus is the same today. And I pray that if you're here, you have had an encounter with Jesus that has changed your life forever. And if you haven't, don't go to bed tonight until you've talked to a Christ follower and discover what it means to make him Lord of your life. But as like-minded members of the 4Cs, we've had encounters that tell us that Jesus is the same today. Because Jesus has met us where we are. He's impressed upon us our real need, our need of salvation. and we have put our faith in him. Because Jesus is able to save us completely, as he is always interceding for us. And the bad news that we're sinners is replaced by the good news that Jesus Christ died for that sin. Jesus does not change. He's the same today, and there's no ebb and flow with Jesus as the circumstances change. I think we can all agree that we're living in challenging times. The pandemic and racial unrest and political division, inflation, and wars, and rumors of wars. But Jesus is the same. There are life-changing circumstances that happen in our lives daily. But Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What can we say about forever? Is that all may change. Everything may change. We can wake up tomorrow with nothing being the same in our lives. But Jesus doesn't change, never will. So let us be bold. Let us be bold in telling the never-ending story of Jesus. Statistics tell us that a smaller percentage of people are attending churches these days. So more and more, we're going to have to be telling the story outside of our church, where the people are, actually. Look for opportunities in your neighborhood, at your kids' school, where you shop. Because pastors, we've been trained for a world that no longer exists. Less people come on a Sunday to hear the story. So we need to take the story to them. Last August, Carlotta and I celebrated our 50th wedding anniversary. And we had an open house where we invited all of our friends and colleagues and all our neighbors. It was a good mix of churched and unchurched people there who came and celebrated with us. Some of you were there that day. We knew some kids would be coming to our party, and we made a game for them. And we posted 15 of our favorite scriptures on great big signs all around the yard and out in the woods. And we handed the kids little cards with the scripture reference on them, and they would have to hunt for the posted scripture and check it off that they found all the scriptures. And when they found them all, they'd get a prize, like a sticker or a popsicle. I mean, kids are easy, right? You can. Yeah. Well, what we didn't appreciate or anticipate is that some of the adults wanted to play that game. Many of them did. We didn't discourage it. Our new neighbor, Beth, was very happy to have found all the verses. And she said that she took some pictures of many of them that spoke to her. And then she asked me if indeed these were all verses of the Bible. And I assured her that they were, and we'd be happy to explain how those verses had spoken to us. So as you go, make disciples. Look for opportunities to tell the story. You know, each year in the news, there's often the heartwarming stories that happens every year, a few times a year. There's these heartwarming stories of a miracle birth. You know the ones where the woman doesn't quite make it to the hospital and either her husband or a paramedic or an actual stranger winds up delivering the baby. And at the end of the newsreel, either David Muir or Nora O'Donnell, they'll try to tear up a little bit and they'll say, doesn't that really pull at your heartstrings? we have a better story. We got a more miraculous story. We have a pregnant, unwed teenage girl sometime way back when Quirinius was governor of Syria. She had to walk or ride on a donkey for some 90 miles to appear at the hometown of her intended for a census. It would have taken her at least a week for this pregnant teenage girl to make this trek. And as they came there, the time of the baby's birth had come. Who's surprised? She just went 90 miles. But there was no shelter there, but a stable. And that unwed pregnant virgin girl gave birth to the Savior of the world, and it's a true story. And that tops the story that David Muir is going to give on the 6 o'clock news. There's another popular news story. It comes out every year as well. It's about corrupt people swindling people out of money. And then that finance person or the politician or the Bernie Madoffs of the world, they go to prison and they die. And there's no redemption. We've got a better story. There are these two guys. One's named Zacchaeus, the other's named Levi, changed his name to Matthew. These two were local agents working for an occupying government. Their job was to collect taxes for their nation's oppressors. And they were able to collect what was owed to Rome and send it to them. And anything over and above their requested amount, they could keep it off for themselves. So they were free to fleece the people for all that they were worth. Do you know what happened to those two scoundrels? I bet you do. They gave their life to Christ. They gave their lives to Jesus. They repented of their sin. One agreed to pay back double all of his ill-gotten gains. The other became the apostle who wrote the book of Matthew. True story. It's a better story, because it's a story of redemption. We have the stories of redemption that the world needs to hear. We must tell those stories in the most engaging ways that we can. We have to be having more spiritual conversations than what we've been having. Back in 2009, I was flying back from our annual gathering in Colorado Springs. Dr. Ken Swetland, one of our former professors and a 4C pastor, led the morning Bible time that year. And he told the story of Dr. Haddon Robinson. He said that every time Dr. Robinson flew on a plane, people asked him what he did. He never told them that he was a pastor or a preacher, never mentioned. Told them he was a professor or a teacher. And when he was asked why, he said every time he said he was a pastor, people stopped engaging with him, stopped talking to him. They went back to reading their book. He felt that conversations had a better chance to lead in a spiritual direction if he didn't disclose up front that he was a pastor. So just having heard this, at our conference in Colorado, I'm on a flight, and I'm sitting next to this very talkative guy. Tells me a good deal about himself. And then he says, "What do you do?" Well, if I tell him I'm a pastor, he goes back to reading his book. So I say, "I work with groups of people in New England. I work with groups of people in New England that want to live out a shared life and a shared mission." He goes, "Really? How's that working out?" I said, "You know, actually, it's going quite well. I currently have over 100 groups in New England that I visit, and they try to live out this shared life and shared mission." He said, "Well, pardon me for asking." He said, "But I come from California. and I'm familiar with communes. He said, do these people all live together? I said, oh, no, they have individual dwelling places, but they do come together at a central meeting place. He goes, well, how often do they meet? I said, well, that can vary. I said, some of them meet, I mean, they all meet at least once a week. Some meet two or three times a week. He said, and you visit them? I said, oh, yeah. Then I said, oftentimes when they come together for worship, I bring the message. Just about then, the light bulb goes off in this guy's head. He goes, wait a minute. You're talking about churches. You must be some type of minister. I said, yeah, sure. He said, well, why didn't you say that in the first place? I said, if I'd done that, you'd go back to reading your book. We wouldn't be having this conversation. He laughed and he said, you know, you're probably right. He said, that was really clever, the way you did that. He appreciated it. But now we're engaged in conversation. And I could ask the question, are you a person of faith? He said, no. He said, my mom, she dropped me off at the Methodist church when I was little, but you know, I've never been back. So here's your opportunity. I said, we are on a plane. If this plane goes down, what do you think happens? He says, I believe it's the end. It's just the end. He said, I'm gonna go down for a real long dirt nap. I'm gonna take a long dirt nap. I told him I came from a very different perspective. He said, I bet you do. And I said, I believe there is a God of the universe. I think there is a day of judgment. I think there is a little place called heaven and hell. And we'll all spend eternity in one of those two places. He said, yeah, I've actually heard that before. I heard that belief before. So I said, if you're right, and our plane crashes, and it's the end, we're both just going to go down for a long dirt nap. There's no harm, no foul. And I said, but what if I'm right? He goes, well, I guess I'm toast. We both laughed a little bit, and I said, you know, it's just that both things can't be true. And he said, excuse me, what? I said, well, both those things can't be true. Either there is a God of the universe, or there isn't a God of the universe. There is heaven and hell, or there isn't heaven and hell. I said, we both can't be right at the same time. So at the end of that conversation, at the end of the plane flight, he shook my hand real heartily, shook it really good. He said, thank you for that conversation. We won't necessarily know the results of our conversations. And that's okay, because the results are up to God. We just need to be obedient in telling the story. And then sometimes we're blessed to see how the Holy Spirit has intervened, and perhaps a conversation we had was used by the Holy Spirit to make an impact. There's this lady in my community, her name is Bev. I've known her for over 40 years now. And my daughter grew up close friends with her niece, and they would go swimming at Auntie Bev's pool because Bev was a nurse married to a doctor, and having no kids of their own, they were generous to the neighborhood children with their pool. So last month I visited Bev in the hospital. She was facing some really, really tough choices. Her ailments were such that she wouldn't survive without any surgery. But those prospects of surgery and tremendous complications were, with an uncertain recovery, was more than she could deal with. At her hospital bedside, she told me that she was going to be choosing hospice, no longer going to fight the illness. And at that very moment, they whisked her away for some more tests, and I didn't have the opportunity to talk to her about that monumental decision. So I visit her again a few days later, and she'd been transferred to the hospice, and I was prepared to tell her the story. I knew that in addition to being active in our community for the last many years, she was somewhat active in the church as well, but I wasn't quite sure what she believed. So after some small talk, I steered the conversation toward eternity and where she was going to spend it. She gave me a great smile. She said, "Terry, do you remember doing my husband's funeral?" I said, Oh, Bev, wow, Dr. Ed, right? That was some time ago. She said, "Yeah, Terry, that was 22 years ago. He died when I was 66, and I'm now 88. She said, "Do you remember sitting on my deck with me overlooking the pool and me asking you where you thought Ed was?" I said, "No, I'm not remembering that conversation." She said, "Well, you told me that you didn't know where Ed was because Ed wasn't a churchgoer. You hadn't really known him. You didn't know that he ever expressed a faith. But you explained in great detail that didn't have to be the case for me. You shared with me the gospel message, and I've had the assurance of my salvation for the last 22 years. I'd already told her the story 22 years ago, and I may have forgotten, but Jesus doesn't forget. So, if I try reconverting any of you, just interrupt me. Well, let's have the conversations. Can we have the conversations? Because you may be the ninth time someone has heard the gospel. And you may be the fifth different person to share the story. Or you may be near the end of a person's incubation period when someone realizes that they need a Savior. We have to love to tell the story. Like the old hymn says, "I'd love to tell the story, unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true, because it satisfied my longings as nothing else would do. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love." I want to close. Everybody loves those words, you know. Everybody perked up just saying, "Oh, he's going to close." That's only the first time I've said it, though, so it's beautiful. I want to close with a word of encouragement, perhaps some application. It's in a sermon by Alistair Begg. He points out that the two verses bracketing our teaching verse this evening are important to reflect on. So our teaching verse, Hebrews 13:8, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Right before that, verse 7 says, "Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their life and imitate their faith." We have been so blessed to have the leaders that we have. I've been with the conference 25 years, 10 as a settled pastor, 15 working for the conference. And I've had the most godly men and women to work with. Men and women of faith. Men and women of conviction. We have leaders who spoke the word of God, and we consider the outcome of their life, and we imitate their faith. In my first year with the Four Seas, Paul McFeeters, at that time, he was the area representative for like all of New England. He took me to lunch. Well, he had me at lunch. He took me to lunch, He introduced me to the four C's. He led me through the credentialing process. And I knew after that meeting that I was with God's people. I could follow their leading. I could imitate their faith. At my first annual gathering of the four C's in 1998, the Reverend Sam Hemberger was giving the evening sermon. Now, Reverend Hemberger had been the 4C missionary at large from 1967 to 73, and then he came as a conference minister from 71 to 81. So his last year as conference minister was 1981. He wasn't a young man then. And here we are, 1998, some 17 years later, and he gave the most compelling, firing gospel message with great energy, slapping the pulpit as well. If it had been a Baptist convention, we would have all gone forward. I knew at that first annual gathering that I was with God's people. I could follow their leading. I could imitate their faith. In the years I've been with the conference, I've served with Cliff Christensen, who came all the way from Minnesota to this little bitty village of Nottingham, New Hampshire, to this tiny little church to speak at my ordination. I served with Steve Gammon, and stayed with him in his home in Minnesota, saw his deep prayer life, even have a prayer closet in his home. And I've served with Ron Hamilton, who has been a brother and a counselor to me. And there are many more who have shown me their faithful leadership and whose faith I can imitate. We are blessed as we remember our leaders who spoke the word of God to us. And we have no difficulty with considering the outcome of their life and imitating their faith. It's been my distinct honor to co-labor and to follow leaders of faith that hold up the name of Jesus and follow his word. Now, on the other side of verse 8, Alistair Begg points out verse 9. It says, "Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by ceremonial foods, which are of no value for those who eat them." We are diligently working at raising up the next generation of leaders for our conference, which you saw today at our delegates meeting. And the 15 years that I've spent in this position has been a period of transition. We are always calling that next church or that next pastor to be part of our kingdom work. And I'm excited about the new pastors being called to the four C's, because we're passing on a legacy. My generation is getting older, and with the raising up of the next generation, we will not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings, because our teaching is Jesus, and Jesus is the same yesterday and today and forever. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your presence in our lives. We thank you for sending your Son that we may be reconciled to you. Our hearts are breaking for the lost. I'm convinced yours is breaking as well. So help us, Lord, to tell the story, your story. Use us, Lord, in all ways possible to reach the lost. It is the assignment you gave us. Forgive us our reluctance. Forgive us for being intimidated. We repent of being lukewarm for you. Present us, Lord, with divine appointments where we can be bold for you in all situations. And thank you, Lord, for this small tribe of faithful followers that have been proclaiming your word for the last 74 years. May we continue to do so through the generations, until you call us home. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Oh, wow. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, man.
Won't you stand as we sing about our marvelous God?
This benediction to be a challenge to all of you, because every one of you know that when we walk through those doors, that's the mission field right out there. So remember, you'll be nowhere by accident this week. Wherever you are, you'll be there by the divine appointment of Almighty God. He will do his work through you this week, because you will be his hands, his feet, and his voice. Because you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. You are the hope of your community. And never allow the thought that I'm no use where I am, because you're certainly no use where you're not. All you have to do is show up. And God has already been where you will be. So go in peace.
I invite you to be seated for a few announcements. All right, a few dozen, but you know, we're not counting. Not really. I want to encourage you to continue to think about the ways we can impact and interact with the hotel staff this week. couple thoughts I was having. One is that as we sit at our breakfast, and they do such a good job of not only offering us the food, but clearing up the tables after us, I didn't think until today, like, what about tipping some of those waiters and work staff that are working so hard? I hadn't thought about that myself. That's something to consider, a way to bless them. We are currently in the midst of a heat wave that is literally melting roads in Europe. No lie. If you haven't checked the news today, that is happening. And so one of the ways we can offer ministry to the people of this hotel is that even as we ask for what we legitimately need with air conditioning, continue to do it with grace and mercy. I have not seen anyone not doing that, but continue that because the heat wave is going to continue and there will be workshop rooms and hotel rooms and maybe even tents again tomorrow that are a little hotter than we would like. And so let's think of those and other ways we can continue to tell Jesus' story, even if we never get a chance to say his name. Tomorrow, our meetings start a little earlier than they did today because of the rest of our schedule. And so just a reminder to you that the delegate meeting will begin at 8:30. There was record attendance there today, I think, for a delegate meeting. And so we've put a call in to the Guinness Book of World Records to see if they'll come tomorrow and count the percentage of conference attendees at a delegate meeting. So come tomorrow and maybe you can help us break that record. It would be awesome. It is a really wonderful time. It's not just a business meeting. It's a great time to celebrate the work that God is doing. That means coffee is earlier, so at 9:30 you can have access to the coffee. And also our morning session will start a little bit earlier. Our first session with Ed Stetzer will be at 10. After that session, we'll head back over to the tent for lunch, and there we'll have a Q&A with Ed, and some have asked how they submit questions. Tomorrow morning when you get here, you'll find an index card on your chair. If you have a question you want to submit, you're welcome to put it on there. We'll collect those and see how many of them we can get to in our Q&A time. In the afternoon tomorrow, remember, we'll have a third workshop slot. Can we thank our presenters from today for the work that they did? Heard some great things about the learning that happened and took place, and I'm looking forward to hearing more about what you learn tomorrow. Tomorrow night, remember, is open for fellowship. Encourage you to make plans and consider calling ahead for reservations for dinner so you can get a table for the number that you need. In the evening, we have available some rooms if you want to have a gathering with some people from a special interest group, a certain region of the country, or a certain ministry that you're involved with. The sign up for that is on the table out where the workshop slips were. And if you need one and there are no more slots left, ask Tim or I about that. Finally, one last thing for everyone. I learned a trick today. If you put your hotel room key in the back of your name tag, it still opens the door. You don't have to take it out. Just so you know, I know, who'd have thought? So there you go, you've learned something now today. And finally, if you are a member of the board of directors, if you could come up here for a few minutes right after the meeting, immediately following, as soon as I say you're dismissed, I'd appreciate that. You're dismissed.